Charleston. A young white man, barely at the age of his majority, walks into Charleston's most storied black church, and before he leaves, a new history is written. Attending a Wednesday night Bible study, he sits for nearly an hour, but his mind isn't on the life of Jesus nor his disciples. It's on murder, mass murder. When the door shuts behind him, 9 black souls, elders mostly, had been slain, Bibles in hand. The man, more boy than man really, hadn't come to learn about religion, for he had a belief, white supremacy, or the profound hatred of black people. White supremacy is the mother's milk of Charleston, of South Carolina, of the South, of America. For surely as slavery funded and built America, the underlying principle was the devaluation, exploitation, and oppression of black life. It's the only thing that makes the church massacre in Charleston even remotely intelligible. 9 black people were sacrificed to the blind idol of white supremacy for the same reason that thousands of black men and women were lynched on American elms and pines, as sacrifices to an idea to perpetuate a system of economic injustice. Dylan Roof, the 21-year-old accused of this massacre, had no friends to speak of, no place to stay other than an associate's couch, no job, and a tenuous relationship with his parents. Isolated, alienated, alone in the world, his sole remaining possession was his whiteness, the only thing that gave his existence meaning. That was the energy that fueled the massacre in Charleston, South Carolina. It now sits like an incubus in the American soul, seething hatred and fear, waiting for more black lives to consume. From Imprisoned Nation, this is Mumia Abu-Jamal. These commentaries are recorded by Noel Hanrahan of Prison Radio.
Okay, oh yeah, Black Sun in the Hizzle, oh, for shizzle, dizzle. We got an excellent show here today. But first, I want to say the views and opinions and that of Comcast. Good thing I got my own sound, because we be flying the plane. Yeah. Andreas, can we turn down the sound, Andreas? Do not crash the plane into Dusseldorf. Andreas, do not crash the plane into Dusseldorf. Andreas.
Y'all know about Dusseldorf?
No.
Andreas, okay. I'm going to fill y'all in a minute. But first, I want to say views and opinions. And that of Comcast. See, that's what happens when I get thrown off here.
Okay, we'll get back on track.
So what about the council?
The views and opinions.
That of the arena does not reflect that of Comcast, its staff, or affiliates. And the views of Black Sun does not reflect that of the arena. We are a council, and I'll explain that in a minute, Don. But to my right,
you know who it is. You know what it is. It's time for Yah, the King of Kings, Lords of Lords. I'm his servant. Get on. Peace.
Okay, my name is Dawn. I'm glad to be here today.
Vince Cheeks, entertainer, activist.
Do not crash the plane.
Thank you.
God dang it, man.
Thank you. They're the plane.
Hold on. See, the neighbors always say we don't affect them. Go ahead, yeah.
It's on me.
Good.
What's up, man? I'm glad to be back.
Yeah.
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 That's the type of welcome home my life. Okay.
Yes, sir. Yeah. Yes, sir. All right. We got a couple of announcements. Then we have a very serious topic we're going to delve into. I need to sit down. I'm cutting my head off. Mm-hmm. First announcement, happy Father's Day to all of the fathers out there. That it is Father's Day to all the great dads that work hard. George, I see you. Happy Father's Day, brother.
May I make one announcement?
Yes, sir. Go ahead.
Ramadan Mubarak.
Yes.
Yeah.
Father. Bless Ramadan for the
for all the goddamn
for the
terrorists
Iquani,
out
for the Iquani, for the Iquan.
I'm sorry.
For the Iquan. Yeah.
All right. For the Iquan. So, being today is Father's Day, we all know that parenting is our most precious profession. So there's going to be an outreach, community outreach, Saturday, June 27th, 11 a.m. to 2 p.m. at the Exchange Park Recreation Center, 2771 Columbia Drive, Decatur, Georgia 30034. For information, you can call 404-687-2000. 3430. Again, this is a parenting community function for single fathers, but especially our young teen fathers out there, those who may need guidance and assistance with fatherhood. So it is a parenting session, Saturday, June 27th, 11 a.m. to 2 p.m. Also, Monday, June 22nd, tomorrow, Hot Block Awards, Ghetto Messiah nominated hottest club host of the year.
Yeah, yes. Ghetto Messiah.
Hopefully I can bring
healing
home
the people.
Bring it home.
Trophy.
Bring it home.
That's tomorrow, 2 to 9 p.m. at the Crow's Nest, so please come check us out. Wednesday night, I'm at Elegance Lounge, 5499 Memorial Drive for Plugged In Wednesdays with Universal Possibilities. And then Friday night, we're at Level 2 Tower Boulevard on the south side. Okay, we have a very serious topic to delve into here. I'm sure everybody's heard about the shooting that happened on the 17th. First of all, I want to start with the names of the victims, because every show that I've seen, every news broadcast I've seen about it starts with this guy. We'll get to him in a second. The coward is what I call him.
Right. Mm-hmm.
But the victims were Reverend Clemente Pinckney, Reverend Daniel Simmons,
sure.
Cynthia Hurd,
sure.
Sharonda Singleton,
sure.
Myra Thompson,
sure.
Tawanza Sanders,
sure.
Reverend DePayne Middleton Doctor,
sure.
Susie Jackson,
sure.
and Ethel Lance. Rest sure. in peace to the victims of this horrific, hate-filled, terroristic act.
Did you say terroristic?
I did say terroristic, and I would love to call this show In the Eye of the Storm. His middle name was Storm, and he came in quiet in the night, and when he erupted, it was nothing but
he carnage. Came something like Jesus.
We about to get to it, we about to get to it, aren't we? Praise white Jesus.
I thought the storm.
Praise white God.
I guess
this is the arena here.
Okay.
Praise white Jesus, yeah. Yanga.
White Jesus.
Okay. Well, love your enemies.
White Jesus.
Love your enemies.
Love your enemies. Turn the other cheek.
Turn the other cheek.
I'm glad you mentioned that, brother. Yes, sir. Because I was going to get to that, but you want to.
I want to expose the culprit.
Okay, yeah. Well, let me get to the backstory.
Okay,
we're
going
back to the culprit and everything.
Do you need a gavel here, Yanga?
No.
Okay, on June 17th, which was this past Wednesday, 2015, Dylan Roof went to the historic Emmanuel AME Church in Charleston, South Carolina around 9 p.m. He drove 2 hours to get there. He sat in the Bible study with them for an entire hour before he opened up on these people, killing 9 people, 3 men, 6 women, and there were 3 survivors. It's said that he used a .45 caliber handgun in the commission of this heinous act, where he reloaded 5 times.
What?
Yeah.
And nobody stopped him. Nobody bum rushed him.
Wait. According to you, Gideon, y'all supposed to do all that, ain't he?
Oh, wow, man. No, you
isn't y'all supposed
down.
To come down okay, in a great cloud and part the sea and stop the shit here? I'm
sorry.
No, because that's along the same lines of what Yanga was saying. Let's be sure that Yah and Jesus is two different people, two different entities.
He reloaded.
Come out of the same book, though, right?
And they're preaching the same message, you know.
Turn the other cheek.
And I love my brother Gideon, but they tell me if it walks like a duck and quacks like a duck, damn it, it's a duck.
That's right.
So we still teaching a passive philosophy. It was the I'm not going to take over because
we're trying to get you.
We have accepted. The fact that white Jesus, first of all, has been accepted. This multiculturalism, this integration type of attitude. If you were a black man, had a black man walked into a white church, he would have been stopped at the door.
Exactly.
First thing they wouldn't want to know who you here to see.
Exactly.
The free lunches are in the back.
Yeah. My bucket is in the back.
My bucket is in the back. He would have not been allowed to sit an hour in their Bible study. But since Jesus is white, then this guy here must have been Jesus' kinfolk.
And they were
honored.
Yes, sir.
To have this cop. That was probably the best sermon they ever gave.
Yes, right. Sir.
They probably put on a show. Exactly. And all the while he's sitting there for an hour and all going through it. Look at his big lip, big nose, black monkey. But he was getting angrier.
That's it.
By the minute.
That's right.
Until he couldn't take it. Until he erupted.
That's right.
Into his uncivilized nature, his very true nature.
Exactly.
Came out. And this is what's happening with the Caucasian here in America. This is what's happening with the white man here in America, and it's fostered and it's endorsed and it's sponsored and supported by a system that allows police first.
Yes, sir.
Their own agents of repression, their own agents of violence
come
into our communities and destroy us, to murder and maim us, to torture us, to kill us.
Yes, sir.
But to torture us.
That's right.
And when you have this type of environment, when you have a system that says this is okay to do, you have the citizens that are encouraged by this.
That's right.
And they go out and they start to take it because they hate us.
Yes.
And until we understand that they hate us, he hated them. Mm. Those who snapped the brother's spine three times hated him.
Come on now.
Brother Freddie Gray. Thank you, brother.
Sir.
So this is an environment of hate. Mm-hmm. So just like any terrorist thing, just like you condemn, just like they say they condemn the terrorists who did it, they go after these countries, say that they are state-sponsored terrorists.
I'm saying today,
I'm telling you, everybody on this panel, that it is state-sponsored terror.
That's exactly what it is.
That he is an agent.
Yes, sir.
Let me back up some facts here, Ganga. Because the judge, since when in human history do you give a psychotic serial killer murderer a bond?
Exactly.
But you got brothers that will get bonds and bench warrants for goddamn traffic tickets.
Yeah. Exactly.
Well, I think it's even. Oh, I'm sorry.
Go ahead.
Well, I think some of the things that I've heard about this case, it makes your blood boil. Mm. You know, just some of the ways that they treated him. He had a bulletproof vest on his way into custody.
And he was not handcuffed.
You know, there's even a story that apparently he was hungry, and so the cop stopped by and got him some Burger King. So there's also that as well.
He's gonna be rewarded well.
Oh yeah.
So it's like. When different people do different things, like 9/11, everybody was just, you know, they were ready, you know, when they were ready for revenge, they were talking about killing and all this other stuff and, you know, tracking down Osama bin Laden and killing him. Mm-hmm. However, you know, with this guy, they're just like, even the judge said, you know, the victims are really his family,
the murderer's
family.
Yeah.
Really? Trayvon, Mike Brown, like Rekia Boyd, all those other people. Mm. They cannot be innocent.
Right. Disregard the family, the family of the nine who were slaughtered.
Yes.
Disregard them. But the killer's family. You know, we got to look at our own kind. Now you're going to give me my own
Because you're a nigger. You see, and as long as we accept, first of all,
a nigga that loves white Jesus,
there it goes. And that the same, this is what I'm saying. Like Sister Don said, when we talk about 9/11, they're Jesus, they're white Jesus. See, white Jesus is for white family and white power.
Exactly.
And so during 9/11, that's the very same white Jesus in the name of God and the righteous United States of America will go and bomb. If you get some terrorists that take two hostages, they will bomb a country.
Yes, sir.
They have.
You know what I'm saying? They have bombs. So this is what their white Jesus tells them.
Exactly.
And our white Jesus tells us, these bootlicking, handkerchief head, buck dancing Negroes, to get up here and to steal. Start forgiving, still show the people, they will still tell you, don't be angry.
Oh, child, know you
Jesus forgives.
We still
forgive
you.
Come on, jump on in here, baby. Come on.
Yeah,
Let me
finish up with this.
Address the point that Brother Yang is making about white Jesus.
Uh-oh.
Because.
Y'all make a distinction.
There is a distinction.
Exactly.
a distinction. Again, I want to say rest in peace to the victims because I don't want to come off as being disrespectful to them at all.
Mm-hmm.
But today they did have the first service at Emmanuel AME in remembrance of the victims from Wednesday night shooting.
Hmm.
And I went to bed last night with the TV on the news channel because I knew when I woke up, they would be talking about this.
Mm-hmm.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm.
And so I wanted to see this service. And so I wake up and I hear the choir singing, you know, which is normal. And then I just start hearing, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Mm-hmm. Just shout it out through the Jesus, Jesus. Mm-hmm. I wake up, I'm listening. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Help us, Jesus. You know, mm-hmm. you know, and I'm like, well, that's part of the problem right there.
Exactly.
They should be screaming Yahshua.
Mm-hmm. First of all,
through my elder Gideon.
Through the Spirit of the Most High. Go ahead.
Oh, Jesus.
You're kidding. You're screaming Jesus. Nah. What Jesus are you screaming out? White Jesus, black Jesus.
Well, right. Thank you, Yanga. Thank you.
There is only black Jesus to me. So.
I object. It's the same concept. Don't y'all understand this?
It's not the same.
It's concept. The same. It's the same with the same
it
book.
It is not the king's. First of all, I don't read the book. So you can't come at me with the book. I done told you and Yanga that. I don't read the Bible. Mm-hmm. So you can't come at me with that. Mm-hmm. Next point.
Oh?
It's, yeah.
If the white man is not putting you on a terrorist list like they are this man, then you're no threats. Okay? I mean, Muslims. Okay. Muslims are a threat because their doctrine teaches, they don't teach a turn the other cheek. It teaches a form of nationalism. It teaches self-determination. And that's why it's a threat. So if you talk about black Jesus, white Jesus, Chinese Jesus, it's still the Jesus within their concept, meaning be obedient to your master. Ain't that right, Gideon?
No.
Obey your master.
I'm not obedient.
Obey your
I'm
master. No, but he said that.
Oh, well.
He said that. He said he's a servant of Yah. He is a meek, humble, but that is slave talk, man. And I'm sick of this slave
Let
talk.
Let him finish. Let him finish. Go ahead, sir.
What is slave talk?
Well, I mean, don't prime the pump. Go ahead and
Yanga, tell him what slave talk is.
Slave talk is just submissive talk. When you have subjugated yourself, when you see yourself in an inferior position and you think that that is the natural order of things, then that's slavery. Because slaves aren't born; slaves are made.
Well,
that's
right. Man.
The Bible.
But go ahead and make your point, though. You were making a point.
And I apologize, Vince. That's only for people who read the Bible. The Bible says, slaves, obey your master.
It does.
Let him go ahead and
obey your master.
And then I'll deal with it.
Go ahead.
Go ahead. This is dictatorship here today.
No, Gideon, go ahead. Go ahead. Go ahead, Gideon. I want you to address that. Because, again, this. For me, it's two different entities. You know, there's the black. I saw a meme on.
Okay. We're not gonna have church today. Can we get some armed guards up in the goddamn church?
Well, first of all, you can't have a show about a massacre.
I'm sorry. Go ahead.
That happened
sorry,
in a church, and then not expect guys to be brought up into the conversation.
Can we get that
is a very good point.
I mean, that is a very good point. Which is why
I apologize.
Which is why I thought you accused yourself from the show originally.
You know what? Thank you, Vince. Thank you, Vince.
You know what I mean? Like that.
Thank you, Vince.
That's not
bringing reason to the.
This is why we have a council.
Right. Emotional response.
What were you saying, Vince?
Let's get back to the coward and what Yanga was saying about white Jesus. Because to his point, in slave, we were given white Jesus during slavery.
Yeah.
And so we're taught to be passive and submissive. But my thing is, we got black people out there praying to the white Jesus saying, God help us, please stop the violence. Then you got Ruth.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Praying to white Jesus,
exactly.
Who's saying, oh, it's kill okay for me to kill these niggas? Okay, well, somebody wrong.
Exactly.
You know what I mean? Somebody's wrong in that respect. You can't be praying to the same God that
you're not
allowing these white people to kill you mercilessly, and you're begging for him to stop the killing.
I'm wondering if, because I used to be a Christian, and I did read, most of the Bible, if not, you know, a good significant part. I used to also study with people. It strikes me as just, we can't get away from white supremacy when we're talking about Christianity in this country.
Mm-hmm.
Right. And, you know, it's very much a part of American culture and you know, Americanism is very close to Christianity. It doesn't even necessarily resemble what Christianity was when it was in its lands of origin. So that being taught to us, I remember Frederick Douglass in his narrative saying that, you know, the Bible was used as justification because we were the descendants of Ham. Mm-hmm. And so therefore, you know, our lot in life was to be slaves. Now, I think the relationship of the black church in this country and the Bible being given, you know, people are learning how to read. People in the black church was also a space where people could organize, people could learn how to read, people could do different things. So it's very complicated, I think, and especially since this particular church was, I think, if not, was it the oldest?
Yes, in the South.
Mm-hmm. So with this man, this white man who came into this space, by the way, you can't just go up and sit next to the pastor. That's not a regular thing to do.
He was sitting next to the pastor. He sought the pastor out.
Because even among ourselves, we put white people first.
Absolutely. Right.
We put white people first. So they saw, he came to the door and they're just like, oh, come on in, come on in. Because as Jay Smooth and a couple of other people have noted, black people are welcoming. You know, we're trying to make you feel, that's what some people say.
And Vince can back me up with the research. Let's just keep it 100. This is not the first time that a church shooting has happened.
Of course not.
Everybody has forgotten about the church shooting with Creflo Dollar, with the one guy, his fiance was messing around with the other guy, so he just walked in, plugged him in the head, plugged her in the head, then plugged himself in the head.
Wow.
So that's why I bring up the topic of it. I got into many debates, y'all know who y'all are, about why are there not armed, because the AME, the originally was black national, well, they had a sense of black national, and they armed themselves. When did we lose the church arming themselves to this, oh, no, guns are bad? Because if I remember...
Fully integrated.
Oh.
You know, when you fully integrate, see, when we were segregated, I don't care what your religion was, you were black.
Right.
You know, when you integrated... Then it became, I mean, it's always been a race thing, but they hid it behind classism. Certain socioeconomic classes, and they start to elevate and lower other people.
No special effects. So let's kill special effects.
When we did that, that's one of the reasons we started feeling a little more comfortable. But I want to be brief, and I know Gideon wants to say something to talk about. It's all in the perception. It's all in the way that we've been taught. We are a people that have, especially the African here in America, that we have to understand that white supremacy survives when we worship other people's gods. And let's call it what it is.
Exactly. Right. They took away our gods. From,
Somebody said when we worship God, period.
I'm going to tell you. I really believe when African people in America, when black people in America get their own God that speaks like them, that lives like them, that acts like them, that is has their best interest in heart. Not the world first, that their God is an anger, that they have a God of war. When their God, so you look at every people's God, when you attack those people, the God gives them permission to defend themselves and to do what they have to do to ensure their survival. Since we have everyone else's God, that God who is for them will always be a God that keeps us in an inferior position, if that God exists. If it is a, and I know it's Ramadan, my Muslim gonna get mad at me and this and that, but if it is an Arab God, that Arab God will teach you that nationalism is wrong, that you should be all inclusive, that you should love everybody, that it's a humanitarian thing, and will teach that same Arab and will say it and have their prophet say it, say that the best people are the Arab people. And then you get these Negroes, well, the prophet also said if you speak Arabic, you're an Arab. Nigga, I'm sorry to go to my Hebrew Israelite people too. They say Yahshua Jesus say that I came to the Gentile this and that, but he said he came to the house of Israel and he came to them Jews and I'm looking for acceptance of God. We will become Jews.
Get it?
Well, you know, it's an interesting thing. I'm not a political person, but I watch the political atmosphere and the body politics. And one of the things that I haven't heard people mention is that Whitey had already set up the scenario by changing the laws where you could, in fact, carry a weapon in church. They changed the law in Georgia. And that's one of the things that was instrumental and interesting to me.
Why are we slow to it? Why are our people slow to it? I'm all for...
What is the it?
No, let me just say, I'm all for guns. So why don't the it factor is black people arming themselves in the church? Are we just so sacred and so holy that we don't have no common sense?
Well, the interesting.
So, no, there were dangers because there were 12 church shootings in the last 5 years, people. 12.
Well, what you are really identifying is the characterization and the part of our makeup is that we are people of peace.
I have a theory or some conjecture. I think that is
a totally false statement. Now y'all might be from the same tribe, but my tribe was never peaceful.
Okay.
And I can backtrack the tribe, Gideon, the Wagadungu. Since y'all always say, well, what is your tribe? Okay? So never were we peaceful. Never, ever. We were fighting on the slave ships. We were fighting in the plantations. We never stopped.
Peace is a condition.
Well, right.
I think.
And some of us were never conditioned, Jamie.
Right.
Some of us were never conditioned. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
But for some of the tribes that were,
I think that in terms of the way people look at it now.
I don't see no gun in your hand. I don't see you shooting nobody.
I need an army.
Wait. We don't need nobody shooting each other.
What do you know? How long have you been fighting? Your tribe been fighting for years and centuries. How long did it take to build a goddamn army?
I actually think that this is. Here's the thing: you can't tell a man how to fight. You're just telling them to fight.
That's true.
So I think that the arena is a fight.
Oh yeah.
I think the things that we do, anytime we bring awareness, anytime we're getting out here going against the grain, the social order of things, then that is a fight. Anytime you're showing any sign of resistance, that's a fight. Now I hope you're not. So you're not a terrorist. You're not suicidal. Now, if you pick a gun up and run out there, I'm going to have to distance myself.
He's like, I'm not trying to get shot.
Right. I'm looking at you, brother. Right. Because even war takes strategy.
Right. Take strategy. Yeah. So the fight is there. I'm just going to throw mine out there for the record. I don't think naturally that we were, I think that is something we've been, and I hear that a lot, we were accepting people, we welcome people, we were peaceful people. I don't think that was a natural part. One of the crimes that I charged the white man with is the disturbing of the natural evolutionary process of an African people by taking them off of Africa and reconditioning them to be niggers. And part of them being a nigger is putting a peace gene, awakening some peace thing in the back of their head. And how do they do this? And I'm gonna end it. Is because people who comply to the system are rewarded. Those who go against the system are penalized. That's where that peace come in. Those who go against the system are sent to penitentiaries, are murdered and maimed in the streets. Those who comply and conform are rewarded.
What I mean when I say we were a peaceful people, it's because we were too busy being creative, being scientists, being mathematicians. They come in. There's a history of America going into indigenous people, black people, wherever, people that welcome them with open arms, and then they turn around and blow your brains all over. That is in American history. So you can't say that if we're these massive warriors and whatever you just said that we are, why is it that we got conquered so easily? It wasn't. We didn't go out there looking to fight. We were welcoming. We want to show you how to be just as creative and just as smart and just as everything as we are. You talking about a peace gene? They might have a jealousy gene.
I don't think that. I think that a lot of what we're thinking about now is actually something that's very contemporary. Because let's not forget that during the Civil Rights Movement, you had the Deacons for Defense.
Yeah, that's right.
There's a book called That Nonviolent Stuff Will Kill You by Charles S. Cobb. He was one of the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee, also known as SNCC.
That's right.
And so when he described Martin Luther King, he said this in interviews everywhere. He said Martin Luther King was a man of the South. Meaning he had guns.
Yeah.
Okay. And in fact, he describes an incident where you go to go to MLK's house and you might get a piece in your butt. Mm-hmm. But anyway, the thing is that when he started working, from what I understand, with Bayard Rustin, it became more nonviolent. Mm. But do believe there were guns protecting that family.
Absolutely.
And Angela Davis, if you watch the movie Black Power Mixtape, she has like a brief snippet where she said after the 16th Street Baptist Church in Birmingham
bombing
that night that the men in her town armed themselves. and protected the town.
So, Don, I'm trying to understand.
So the thing is that what I think has happened is the way we imagine the civil rights movement, mm-hmm. our memory has been tampered with.
Absolutely.
It's everything is supposed to be peaceful.
Yeah.
You know, it's like we're supposed to march, sing, we shall overcome, and then that's it.
Right.
Oh,
we got a call.
Oh, good. We didn't even get out the number.
He put it on the screen.
Let's see if we can get this call. And caller, just talk. I don't know if we're going to be able to hear you. Go ahead. All right, keep going, Don.
Okay. So.
The speaker's right there by on the television.
So the memory of the, because I noticed this actually in a lot of current organizing now. Mm-hmm. You know, you have mostly white people, some black people, who are saying we must be nonviolent. And that interpretation even extends to property. You know, when some people were angry about Troy Davis being murdered by the state, they put trash in the streets, and some people felt that that was a violent act. Some people felt that challenging the police was a violent act. But the thing is that it's, I think all of this peace is to contain the anger of Africans here in this country, because they fear retribution.
Yeah.
You know, Thomas Jefferson said it in Notes on the State of Virginia, Query 14, paragraph 264, that they would have memories of all the wrongs.
They wouldn't have to fear retribution if they leave us the
Well, they got white Jesus. They're not fearing retribution.
You know what I mean? If they stop killing brothers and stop making
and
us
sisters.
Angry and sisters, right. We,
and
we
children.
We need to do a show on all the sisters.
Are we really, but here it is, are we really relying on if they would stop? It's in order to continue, that for their continuing, their you know, for them to keep going. Mm-hmm. They are not going to stop murdering and maiming us. I think that that's the biggest thing. We keep hoping and believing that after this many years, this many centuries, that they will accept us as one of their own, that they're going to love us, then we're only deceiving ourselves. This is why I say we go back to the peaceful, us not being peaceful by nature. I don't think that we were sitting there building pyramids and we were doing math and the white man came in and we said, oh, we're going to teach you. And then we looked up, we were in handcuffs. They came like any human being. They came, they are devils. They are full of tricks. And the Native American said, white men speak with forked tongue.
Right.
He's a liar.
But they had so to when lie he comes, manipulate.
But, and they got warriors. Who do you think those slaves were? A lot of them were conquered from wars. They went to one after they played us, one against the
right.
others.
I mean,
they played us. So it wasn't so much,
I agree with
it wasn't so much that we were just peaceful. These crackers, like they do all the time. Can I say that on the air, crackers? These crackers, like they do all the time, came in. They took advantage of a people who wanted more than another people.
They took advantage of a peaceful people. Nobody peaceful. Who was looking for a war.
If you give somebody a gun, how peaceful
nobody
is a man?
For a war.
They weren't looking for a war. They were looking for, like any empire does, economic gain, more land. You not peaceful people don't accept guns. Africans were taking guns to enslave and capture other Africans.
Right.
They were warlike. We were warriors. We just got caught. It wasn't we didn't come out and say, let's sing Kumbaya. We got played. They came. They had something we want. We honorable as hell. We feel like a man is a man. Your word is bond. I'm a warrior. You're a warrior. Okay, we're going to go beat them up. Let's beat them up. While I'm beating them up and bringing them slaves, I bring them on the ship. You done slap me in the ship. I said, oh, damn, you a devil.
That's right.
It ain't nothing about me being peaceful. I was just suckered. You sucking me. But if you give me a chance, take these, like we tell the police, take the badge off. Take the gun. We would tell them, take these chains off. You know what I'm saying? So I don't, and this is just my interpretation. One of the things is I'm not going to say we were sitting there just with the crops and the scientists, that we were a warrior people. And we are now, still to this day, angry and upset. And they still try to trigger this peace gene.
They are trying to. No, they're trying to trigger some violent gene, which is what he was trying to do. The man said he was trying to start a race war.
Yeah.
Okay, this
but it's
dude,
already started.
I mean, the race war started. The race war started when they brought us over.
That's yes,
right. That's right.
You know what I mean.
I mean,
the race war's been going on for a long time. Go ahead, Elder.
Well, I mean, I've really been listening to the emotional response to this issue, and when I said peace, obviously that set off a firestorm. But see, when there is a duality, and of course when I said peace, I'm a warrior. We are people who understand war, but do we really? Because in the art of war there are many tactics, and you mentioned that can be used. Love is a tactic in war. Mm-hmm. Peace is a tactic in war. It's all according to what objective you are trying to achieve. Mm. And that's the misunderstanding, I believe, of the masses of our young people as to what the objective of war is. What is the end game? So when we talk about, just like when we talked about the Palestinian issue, they had been being massacred for all these hundreds of years, and if their strategy does not turn from war to fighting a superior force, they're going to be annihilated. Mm-hmm. So if there isn't, and then the other salient point that Vince brought up, you know, and it's interesting about our people because we sell so much wolf tickets. We going to do that. And they've been killing us and our children and raping our women and doing, and we ain't did diddly squat, but talked about what we going to do.
What we going to do.
So when we begin to
shout
become.
So for all that warrior
talk. No special effects, please. Yeah, no, let's kill that.
All that warrior talk.
So I'd rather be warrior with the special effects. When we talk about war, that's, we're at war now, as Yanga so aptly indicated. It as vehemently, diametrically opposed as Black and I are philosophically as it pertains to deity, I can still love this brother and sit at the same table and watch him beat and, you know, try to block the gavel and all this right here. But at the end of the day, we have mutual points of interest that we both want clean water. We both want places where we can survive and feed our children. We both want education. We are the most intelligent people on the planet. Only warlike, heathen, Neanderthal, regressive, genetically, people revert to emotional outbursts and want to destroy and kill everything. So our intellect and our spiritual connection with our Creator will bring about ultimate peace, because through peace, everybody will thrive.
I'm sorry, didn't Jesus take a whip into the temple and started whipping everybody around when they were making changes?
Well, see, Jesus is a figment of the white man's imagination. Yeshua was the etymologically correct name that can be defined and used. No, well, we're talking about research. We're talking about being able to
research, Gideon.
Yes, research.
Where is Joshua's burial site? Since you want to talk about research,
he did not die to where he was not going to be resurrected.
Here's my thing. I would love to. I would love if we were at a war. In a state of war, a war emergency. I would love that for the Black man. War implies that there's a fight.
Right
now, it's massacre.
It is a genocide
taking place against the African here in America. Exactly. And this is what I think that the American government should be charged with.
Of course.
Yes.
You know what I'm saying?
Malcolm
take it to take, right,
to
exactly.
Take that to
is the charges of genocide. Yes. That I would even like if the young men and women thought we were at war, then they would probably prepare better. They would start doing their canned goods and saying we're on the TV
what?
Show.
No hell.
the canned goods.
How can you not think we're at war?
Because
we're getting shot down in the streets.
You're not, because like what you so adequately said, where are our combatants? Where are our fighters? It is a massacre.
It is not.
They have declared war.
Yes, they have.
They have declared a war.
But see, that's
but
why
when
they
war
let
implies,
the Christians lead, because the Christian philosophy denotes and downplays the fact that we are at war.
Yeah.
And see, the Pinckney, his soul
that,
where
that
he rests,
war has been declared.
He was exactly.
Yeah.
He was a state senator.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
That position did not stop him from still being looked at as a combatant and someone that should be snuffed out.
Yeah.
So once our people begin to go back to our original source, our original culture, our original God, then we will begin to understand what's going on.
So,
I want to say what you said about him being a combatant and a state senator, because that's one of the conspiracy theories as to why he ended up getting shot. Maybe he was the target because he was one that adamantly push for body cameras on all police officers.
Oh, wow.
Right. And it just passed the week before he got killed.
Wow.
Good information.
Wow.
So that's one of the conspiracy theories, that because he was working so hard, you know, against police, as they would say,
well, since we're
talking, he was taken out.
Conspiracy theories, I heard that the shooter was also related to the police officer that shot the guy in the back 8 times.
Well, also,
he wasn't related to him. He was locked up with him in the same jail. He was locked up in the same jail.
But also, so they said that Denmark Vesey, excuse me, was when the uprising and he was hung was on the same date that this guy went in and did the massacre. So that's which reflects upon there being a greater body of people who was training this killer to go in and do what. See, he's part of a movement, and that movement was seen when Obama was elected. They sold more guns and armament. Munitions than they ever have. They sold out. So these white folks are ready for war. But our
ability to declare war.
We just have to have insight and us being able to. We ain't gonna outgun them. We don't make bullets.
Speaking of declarations of war, in the same week, the Fraternal Order of Police, the River City Lodge number 614 out of Louisville, Kentucky, sent an open letter to the news from their president, Dave Mutchler. And, you know, thinking in terms of declaration of war, he says, "Consider this an open letter to the public we serve, the criminal element in our city, and the self-appointed spokespersons who choose to remain blind to reason, who use misinformation, and who sensationalize tragedy at every opportunity to forward their political agendas. Know this. The members of River City FOP, Lodge 614, who serve and protect Louisville every day, will no longer stand on the sidelines while anyone continues to assault and demonize us." Hmm. "To those of you who support us," basically he's like, "We like you, it's cool, too bad they don't ask about you. But this is the part that we need to be concerned about. To the criminal element in our community, we do not fear you. We are not your punching bag, and we will not simply stand by and accept your verbal or physical assaults. No matter what craziness occurs, we will always protect our citizens and ourselves. No matter how weak our criminal system, we will hunt you down again and again until they put you away or you go away."
White power.
She's a punk.
"No matter how weak our policies, we will find a way to make you understand that Louisville isn't where you want to live. More importantly, though, take note of the following. If you actively resist or assault us, we will use every option available to take you into custody. If you use deadly force against us or attempt to use a dangerous instrument or deadly weapon against us, we will use deadly force against you, and we will stop," and "will" is in caps, by the way, "we will stop the threat to us, our fellow officers, or the citizens we serve. To the sensationalists, liars, and race baiters, we are done with you. At first it was good enough just to sit back and watch your ridiculous spectacle. No more. Now your rhetoric, lies, and hate puts all of us, police officers and citizens alike, in danger. From now on, we will call you out each and every time you tell a lie, twist the truth, or otherwise engage in vile behavior meant to push your selfish agendas. If your behavior or untruths causes harm to us or to the public, we will make every attempt to have you investigated, charged, and prosecuted at the local, state, or federal level. Your idiocy and lies are what caused the destruction in Ferguson and other cities around our country, and we won't be tolerating that here. We watched in shock most recently as some of you flat out lied to the media after a critical incident here in Louisville." By the way, that incident was a black man essentially being shot to death because the police officer feared the flagpole that he had in his hands. Mm. And so I've been following up on this. The mayor and the police chief were like, "Whoa, we're not supporting that." And yet, and some people have been calling for this FOP president to step down. But I think this is actually
doing the same thing that New York did when Eric Garner got choked out. They're doing going the same thing. They have more. They turn their back on the mayor.
Yeah.
Same exact thing.
But there is definitely a declaration of war. And this comes from the FOP, which has been known to wage war on black and brown people in this country, especially and particularly Mumia Abu-Jabbar, Free Mumia.
Well, remember now, the police, what was it, in Boston said they were going to do a slowdown. They've got more murders down.
First of all, when they did a slowdown, the murders went down. The murder rate
in New York, yes. People got home.
It went crazy.
Yeah, they went crazy.
Yeah, man, they went half.
They had one of the bloodiest weekends about 3 weeks.
But that goes back to, like,
who provoked that, though? Think about that.
Accountability and responsibility.
Thank you.
We have to have accountability and responsibility.
Among
ourselves. We have to man up and we have to take. This is why I say, go back, that war has been declared on us and war is being waged against us.
Exactly.
You know, I would like to think that we were at a, you know, DEFCON 5 level type thing, that we knew war was going on. But right now, we're just victimized.
We are.
We are being slaughtered. We're being massacred. We're like sheep being led to the slaughter. Due to our social conditioning, economic conditioning, you know, and the way we're being just herded and rounded up like cattle. So the first thing.
Are we like the inmate with the Twinkie on the Snickers on the bed?
Man, all the time. We passed that.
Yeah. We're
like the inmate. He's trying to get that Twinkie back out you.
Exactly.
You know what I'm saying? So, I mean, we're at that level.
Let me say this. Dawn is an anomaly. Why do I say that? Because she has information, she's in touch with the media. Our women, see, our fight is internal, and that's what we've forgotten. We want to go out and march against white supremacy. Whereas we need to go back to our homes, among our children, our families, and unify there. Once we get them unified, because see, our women going to force, they vote more than white women for these killers.
I push back at me being an anomaly, because actually I owe my growth to many men and women who have been in my life.
Sure.
And so, you know, honestly, I like the idea of, I just think that we need to focus our marches in a different way. I think that we need to be more confrontational. I think that we need to stop singing these songs, even though they're good songs.
What do you mean more confrontational? Because somebody could take that and just run with it.
Well, see, the point that I'm making is the confrontation is in our homes, with our families.
But the thing is that my dad did not shoot a whole bunch of people. My dad, it hasn't been, happy Father's Day. My dad hasn't been executing people. My dad drives a Greyhound bus. And his job the week before last was to get my youngest brother into college. You know, that was his goal for all of us.
This is my parents. You're making my point.
Guess what? Only one of his children is challenging the state.
We have to, at the very least,
go up there and say, excuse me, people who want my vote. Why aren't you doing anything about this?
But this is the point.
Why aren't we talking about this?
They are part of the problem. The conspiracy to destroy us is coming from the government. So now, once again, just like he was talking about the white Jesus, and Vince was saying we're praying, the killer is praying to the white Jesus, and these blacks are praying. When we go to the government, they're the ones who've been protecting these killers that have been passing laws to give the killers more rights.
Yes.
So when I say that we need to internalize our fight, that means that it takes us back to our families where we can begin to then educate our family that we are at war. But if we got our women working for the killer, they actually doing all the administrative work.
I think
has to be not just internal but external. You know, when you look at a fight, you know, there's no way that we can go and start to re-educate our families when our children and our women are seeing us get our ass whooped every day. They're not seeing us stand up to the powers that be. You know, they've seen, I mean, it's like with the children today, man, that are being targeted by these police. If they see when a child comes up and realizes that mama and daddy are not the seat of authority, that y'all can't protect me from being harmed, y'all can't even protect me from being murdered.
Then I'm going to call the police on mama and daddy.
I'm going to call the police on mama, right, because that's the authority. So they have to see, when they see that we as a people fight against the very system that is keeping us, that is exploiting us and oppressing us, that's a part of education in the family, and redefine traditional roles of what we think. This is one of, right? I'm a religious brother.
But then let me say this briefly. If they see mom and daddy cussing and beating each other to hell, and can't live in a six-bedroom house.
But that's going to happen if they don't challenge. That's going to happen if they don't.
here's the problem with
that's
all
what
of that.
Confuses them.
Here's the problem with all of that. We keep saying that the problem starts with the family,
it
except
does.
That men and women have to endure under a system of white supremacy
yes.
every day.
Yes.
That's true.
Like when
that's
they
true.
Get home, they get home beaten.
Sure.
And so it's just like, really, honestly, we need to find a way for these people to fight back. I think that
exactly.
a diversity right. of tactics are good. Some people do lobbying. Some people do other things that I won't mention on this TV.
Mm-hmm.
But I feel very strongly that going back to saying, you know, well, we're not behaving, we're not doing this stuff. I'm just like, wait a minute.
Right.
You know, like we have and family can actually be defined in a wonderful way. There are people that I've adopted as part of my family,
okay.
people who are my brothers and sisters,
sure.
people that I care about.
Right.
We got to fight together. You come against one of us, you're coming against all of us.
And
we need to have that heart.
And let me add on to what Don is saying, Gideon. You could be a good dad, you have a son. Vince could be a good dad, you have a son. Yanger, you a good dad, you have a son. You know, I could pass policy. I don't care how good your family household is. If all three of your sons hang out, you are a gang, and I can shoot on sight.
That is a problem.
And they have.
So that's a reality.
They have.
That does not change the fact that the system, like you were saying, white supremacy will come after all three of your sons and get them down like dogs.
Well, they, what you did okay. was just prove my point, because it's the system that creates policies to villainize
no,
our children
no.
just because they're swearing.
This is my thing. This is my thing.
But you got to stop that policy.
For you warriors.
That's me.
Because
that's
me. I mean, and I understand the warrior spirit, because when I first saw this story Thursday, I got angry and I wanted to, and my warrior spirit did rise up. But I'm in control of my warrior spirit, and I know that there are reasonable ways to go about doing things. And the reason I say reasonable, because y'all keep talking about fight, fight, fight.
Mm-hmm.
One, no one has taken the fight to these white people for
right.
the centuries that we've been here.
No,
two,
wrong.
That's
not
wrong. That's
wrong.
No,
I'm talking about physically. Y'all talking
Haiti?
About
that's,
y'all
that's
talking
just
about
not a fact.
Fight.
That's not a fact.
Even physically we have.
Let it make it fun. Let it make it
stop. Gideon, it's not true. The rebellion is not stopping here. Wait.
Can I?
For the first show, it was a shootout.
Yeah,
where I grew up in. What, so you're not going to talk that on the arena. Not here,
what,
man.
What fight have you taken to white supremacy?
Are you serious?
My uncle.
Yeah, tell me.
Okay,
no.
Tell me
what fight, because you keep talking about this fight. I ain't heard about no
man,
fight against white supremacy on the news.
We can go all the way back to that Turner.
Where's this
fight? We can go. We have been fighting whites. We can go back to Nat Turner.
Yeah.
We have been fighting white supremacy since we've been brought to the show. Yes.
Yes. Slave results were actually a regular thing.
But then the point, you already brought out.
Or were they talking about taking to white supremacy and taking down white supremacy? I'm not talking about a slave revolt trying to get away for your freedom.
No, it ain't about trying to get away from your freedom.
Y'all keep sitting here talking about
the Black Panther Party.
Y'all keep sitting here talking about fighting. Well, y'all ain't declaring no war. What you keep talking about?
We don't
about
have
fight,
to declare.
Fight.
Why are we declaring war when war has been declared
well,
on us?
Well, you need to tell the people there's war going
but
on.
That's
what we're
trying to do. Because our time is short. Let
right.
Develop
but y'all, my point is, you jumping on y'all jumping on me and getting
because
we holler.
I'm saying, we
holler about being
peaceful.
Because
y'all
holler about being
peaceful. When you're getting your head busted, y'all hollering peace. Hell yeah, we're going to jump on that.
Right, but where's the fight that you're I don't see you fighting. I see
I'm
you
fighting every
fight.
Day.
I don't see you fighting.
I'm fighting every day. I'm
you
not the,
about,
I'm not the brother going to get my head busted
and
holler about.
Y'all talking about soft and peaceful and this and that.
And soft and peaceful.
There's a better way to politically correct this system without going, starting a race war. Y'all talking about giving in to a race war on you. Way y'all coming off.
Don't you
like,
know you were fought the descendant of slaves, black
saying
man?
That we need to be going physically fighting them, right? Is that,
I'm
is,
saying,
is that correct? Is that not what y'all just said when they went to this warrior talk?
Did I say that?
Well, what type of fight are you talking about?
First of all, Yanga said, please define this fight.
What did I tell
you? Yanga said there are many ways to fight.
Yes.
Okay?
Right.
There are
many times on here, we done talked about political solutions. So, just part
because
of
because they got y'all Negroes scared of throwing punch. Don't put that back on me.
But I'm saying, why you got to jump on the peaceful way to fight? You saying that
peacefully? How do you fight peacefully?
What they doing? What they doing?
I'm gonna bleed all over you. I'm gonna bleed all over you.
Praying, right? If you go to South Carolina right now, it's white, black, Spanish, Asian, everybody.
And that's how the white boy got in the church to start killing us in the first place. Right.
What I'm saying to your point is you keep talking about there's more than one way to fight. Why you got a guy in the way to fight?
What is a black guy? That's an oxymoron.
There is a more peaceful, sensible, reasonable way than starting
a race war. How do you peacefully? How do we start? Nobody's starting.
Okay. Let him speak.
This is what I said.
Y'all talking about going into battle.
At the beginning of the show, I said every church should arm themselves. Right. Every church should have metal detectors. That's what I said.
Who going to finance all that?
Already been defeated.
Yes.
We already saying we can't win.
Right.
We already saying we gonna go in with a peaceful fight.
If we can't rationally and reasonably, Why should we even vote? Isn't that another way to fight? Black Sun has actually consistently talked about voting on this show.
Black Sun always talks about voting on this show. Right. Always.
What I'm saying is that is a peaceful, rational, reasonable way to fight these bigoted laws that are set up against us.
It's not the end game. It is a peaceful fight. It is a non-violent fight. When people talk about peaceful, the people who got lost their lives to vote
wasn't unpeaceful about that.
No.
We need to quit pussyfying this thing. Can I say that on TV? We need to quit pussyfying this thing. You know what I'm saying? I mean, we need to.
Well, considering the only one who possesses one.
Yeah. So, yeah, we need to quit making this thing. There is no soft way out of our condition.
How much time?
I'm saying
can I say something?
It's not reasonable or rational.
Can I say something?
Because like Elgin said, we don't make not now bullet, not
it's
now
gun.
Can I say something?
You changed it.
Can I say something? You know, just a little bit of something, something.
Go ahead.
So a lot of times when people talk about tactics and regarding violent and nonviolent, there are people who choose nonviolent tactics when it's strategic to do so.
Certainly.
I think about Stokely Carmichael, Kwame Ture. Mm-hmm. He said that he would, you know, when they were going into parchment and they were, you know, they were doing the hunger strike. He said he wasn't going to do this again.
Right.
Second, you know, he was saying this is a nonviolent tactic.
Right.
He also said that for nonviolence and peacefulness to work, your enemy has to have a conscience.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And the thing is that we are in a state. One thing that I have gotten sick and tired of, you know, I've been following this case. I've been talking to different people. I have seen white people center white women's bodies in this. They're just like, well, as white feminists, you know, white men rape us too. And I'm just like, wait a minute. This is where you need to stand up for your black sisters because a part of state law, you know, rape has been a tool of the slave master. And I just want to say that there's a difference between nonviolent and peaceful. There's very different. And there's no peace without justice.
And I've always said that a fight is a fight. Even if you can't swing, spit, holler. A fight is a fight. Hold on, hold on.
First of all, I love you, Vince,
but that is so policious. Nobody's going to, first of all, if you were doing something, if you were,
Right.
I'm Yanger. I would never say it on television.
Right. And you
that's the first thing. Secondly, to say that we have never physically attacked a system that has white supremacy really shows a lack of black history homework, brother. We have physically went after this beast when the time is married. No, we're not warmongers.
I'm not saying black people have never fought. That's not what I'm saying. I'm trying to address the point that y'all was making right now about taking this physical arm and going to war.
When did that ever come out of our mouths,
though? Y'all said that when y'all first started. I'm a warrior, and you peaceful punks need to do this.
What is a physical peaceful revolt? I know we've had peaceful fight against this system, but what I was envisioning y'all talking about.
Now y'all changing it.
No, it's not about changing. I was talking about self-defense, though.
That's what I was hearing. I was hearing them talk about self-defense. Metal detectors. Metal detectors. You know, so when this dude comes in, you can't come in.
The way I was envisioning what y'all was talking about, that's what I was talking about when I said black people have not fought the system like that. Because I'm thinking y'all talking about arming to the teeth, tanks, choppers going all out with these.
That's what the state does. White supremacy.
Right. But the state has the equipment and the money to do that.
Yeah, the war's already started.
That's why I said we're not at war. It's a massacre on our end. If we're at the point when I'm telling you, reformism doesn't work for us. You know what I'm saying? Reform can be a step to revolution. But we're at the point that even everything natural defends itself. A rose has a thorn. And when black people get to the point where we have laid down and won't, even if it's physical, I'm not advocating attacking. We don't do like the white man going to a white church and fire on innocent people. But I'm saying that in combat, when you are being attacked, when your women are being attacked, when 12-year-old Tamar Rice is being attacked and children are being killed, any people that won't physically stand up to defend his women and children are people that are already subject and doomed to death.
Well, that's us today. We're doing that. That's why we're doing all today. That's why we're talking.
But that's why we're talking now.
And like you said, I don't have a problem fighting.
That's all I'm saying is my first mindset is peaceful.
Yeah. That's my first mindset. If we got to get pushed to that point, let him close the show out because we run out of tape. We're still taping. He said done. We're done on the live TV.
But let me just say this, you know, what I was saying was basically churches give the unsure some guns, strap them,